Welcome to Southside Online.
We hope you enjoy the service. Great.
Thank you. every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captive. Stop the Lord, oh my Lord. Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow.
Good morning, Southside friends. It's my privilege this morning to read from Psalm chapter 40. Please follow along with me. I've waited patiently for the Lord to help me. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the pit of despair, out of the mud and the mire. He set my feet on solid ground and steadied me as I walked along. He has given me a new song to sing, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see what He has done and be amazed, and they will put their trust in the Lord. Oh, the joys of those who trust the Lord, who have no confidence in the proud or in those who worship idols. Oh, Lord, my God, You have performed many wonders for us. Your plans for us are too numerous to list. You have no equal. If I tried to recite all Your wonderful deeds, I would never come to an end of them. You take no delight in sacrifice or offerings. Now that You have made me listen, I finally understand You don't require burnt offerings or sin offerings. Then I said, look, I have come, as it is written about me in the scriptures. I take joy in doing Your will, my God, for Your instructions are written on my heart. I have told all Your people about justice. I have not been afraid to speak out, as You, O Lord, well know. I have not kept the good news of your justice hidden in my heart. I have talked about your faithfulness and saving power. I have told everyone in the great assembly of your unfailing love and faithfulness. Lord, don't hold back your tender mercies from me. Let your unfailing love and faithfulness always protect me. For troubles surround me, too many to count, my sins pile up so high, I can't see my way out. They outnumber the hairs on my head. I have lost all courage. Please, Lord, rescue me. Come quickly, Lord, and help me. May those who try to destroy me be humiliated and put in shame. May those who take delight in my trouble be turned back in disgrace. Let them be horrified by their shame, for they said, aha, we've got him now. But may all search for you, be filled with joy and gladness in you. May they who love your salvation repeatedly shout, the Lord is great. As for me, I am poor and needy. Let the Lord keep me in his thoughts. You are my helper, my savior. Oh my God, do not delay.
Well, hello from Camp Harmattan. It's great to be here this week. Weather is beautiful, a place that holds great memories for so many of us. So it's been a great treat to be here with some of our friends from Southside this week. I'm kind of close to the river, so I apologize if you hear that in the background, although I don't apologize, it's beautiful here. I do apologize if a truck goes past a couple of times. Hopefully you'll hear me clear enough for this message. I've kind of found a sheltered spot from the sun, but also a kind of a quiet spot as well. Hopefully that we can have this time together as we look at another psalm. I love reading the psalms. I love, not only are they just great poetic messages or so relevant for so many of us, no matter what season we're going through, the psalms just speak to us in what God is speaking to us in that season. But what I also love about the psalms is the kind of the behind-the-scenes story of David's life. I mean, we read about him in 1 and 2 Samuel and other places too, but mainly those places. But the Psalms is kind of the behind-the-scenes. You know, when you would buy a DVD, those of you who still buy DVD movies, and that gives you the menu option before pressing play, and you can watch the outtakes and the blooper reel and things like that. Often those DVD menus also have a behind the scenes, and so the actors or the director may talk about what it was like making those scenes, probably with mosquitoes all around them like here. And the Psalms are just like that. It's kind of, you read about David's story in 1 and 2 Samuel, and the Psalms are kind of the behind the scenes, what he was going through, you know, the times of being in victory, beating Goliath, you know, and or leading an army, and you read about what his emotions were like in that, or times when he was fleeing for his life, and you read about his emotions, what he was going through, and pleading, crying out to God, lamenting for the moment to be over, or times when he would share his sins, and you know, you read about what he did in those kind of famous sins of his life. But then you get to read about what it was like for him, what he was thinking, what he was feeling, how his emotions were, as he was praying and crying out to God. So I love the Psalms, as they are just a great moment to just sense, okay, what is going on in David's life? And they're so relevant. And here we have Psalm 40. Now, Psalm 40 is a great psalm which gives a great picture of what it looks like to be a growing, maturing believer in God. Because that's what David was. He was someone who didn't have it perfect, and he didn't have it perfect right from the beginning or right at the end, but he was a growing believer. And Psalm 40 really paints a a good picture of this forest. So what I'm going to do, we've already heard the psalm being shared, but what I'm going to do is break it down a little bit. And this is the beauty of scriptures, is it's simple. You know, I could just sit here, Bible, a few notes, and just share a simple message that God just makes it so clear through his word, through his servant David. And Psalm 40, let's break it down a little bit, of this maturing, growing Christian. Because the first few verses, first five verses, David is praising God. He's singing God's praises because he's writing this at a time of he's just been rescued. He's just been delivered from harm's way. He says, I waited patiently for the Lord to help me, and he turned to me and he heard my cry. And he says he's given me a new song to sing. He's put my feet on solid rock. He's grabbed me out of the pit of despair. It's praise. He is going, thank you once again, God, for delivering me, for saving, for rescuing me. And that's the first point for any growing, maturing believer in God, is life isn't rosy. You know that. A growing, maturing Christian will share very happily that life is not rosy. It is not easy. But we are to praise God no matter the season. But so much so when he delivers us, when we look back in our life and go, man, God just, he helped me when I was in that real tough spot. Now I'm going to praise him. I want to acknowledge him and recognize his goodness, his faithfulness to me. And so this is the first part of this, this psalm, is just David reminiscing, going, oh, once again, you are so good, God. Thank you. So the growing believer, first point, is one that is always eager to praise God. Not take the praise themselves, but look to see where God has moved, what God has done, where God is faithful in their life, and share that praise and give that praise to God. So that's the first part. Then David moves on. In verse 6 to 8, he shares this. You take no delight in sacrifices or offerings. Now that you have made me listen, I finally understand. You don't require burnt offerings or sin offerings. Then I said, look, I have come. As it is written about me in scriptures, I take joy in doing your will, my God, for your instructions are on my heart. Here is the second point, is a growing, maturing believer is one that always is willing and humble to listen to God's voice. David here is saying, I finally listened to what you were saying. In this instance, God was saying, David, I don't want you to just be okay with messing up and sinning and then just making an offering to make it right. No, I want you to be obedient. I want a relationship here with you. I want you to trust me. Put your faith in me. Be obedient to my word. And David, at some point, whether it was at night or whether it was time of prayer, it dawned on him. It's like, I get it now. I'm hearing your voice, God. You don't want me just to continue in that old ways of messing up and then sacrificing and then messing up and then sacrificing. No, you want me to be obedient to you. But the maturing, growing believer like David here is one that is always, no matter what stage of life, no matter how long you've been a Christian, always is at a place of going, God, I want to hear from you. I want to listen to your voice. I'm willing to be corrected. I'm willing to learn a new thing of you. I want to continue to grow. I want to continue to mature in you. That's a great place to be. Always willing to learn and grow. And that's what David was. And then he continues. That's the second point. A maturing Christian is a listening Christian. The third point, David then talks about how he's eager to share this goodness. He says, I have, in verse 9, I have told all your people about your justice. I have not been afraid to speak out, as you, O Lord, well know. I have not kept the good news of your justice hidden in my heart. A maturing, growing believer, again, like David, is one that is willing to share the good news, not keep it hidden to themselves. He would face persecution. He could face hardship, death threats, and many parts of the world still face that. But no matter what others may think, no matter what your colleagues, your neighbors, your family, whatever it may be, whoever it may be, think, a mature and growing Christian has a desire to share who they are in Christ, what Jesus has done for them, to share the transformation that has gone on in our life. Don't be so scared and don't be so afraid of what others may think or their opinions on you, but let God speak to you in that moment. As Paul, when he was writing down in 2 Corinthians, that it's in his weakness that God's strength is made perfect. But we have to recognize that. We go, okay, my words aren't always great. I may not have the best vocabulary. I may not always be bold in how I share this. Whatever it may be, your weaknesses or afraid of stumbling, give it to God. The growing, maturing believer is one that goes, it's not easy, but I don't want to keep this hidden to myself. It's too good of a news to keep to myself. I'm going to share this. And that was David. He wanted to share this with all who he was with. That's the third point. The fourth is this. And this is maybe one of the greatest points. It's David was so humble that he wasn't arrogant and said he got it all straight. He's so humble that in his next portion, he talks about his falling shorts, his failings, his sins. He says in verse 11 and 12, Lord, don't hold back your tender mercies from me. Let your unfailing love and faithfulness always protect me, for trouble surrounds me, too many to count. My sins pile up so high, I can't see my way out. You think that's maybe an odd thing for a growing, maturing believer to say, but here's the thing. David was still recognizing that he still had a lot more growing and maturing to do. But he said, God, I need your mercies. I need your love. I need your tender care. I need your strength to do that. And that's the same for all of us. The maturing, growing believer is not one that says, I've got it all straight and set out. But it's one that is humble and says, God, I still got a lot to grow. I still got a lot to ask for forgiveness for. I got a lot of growing, maturing. Jen last week shared of Psalm 1 and that image that we have of that tree planted by seasons that is growing and growing strong no matter the season, bearing good fruit and good leaves. Well, that's that growing believer is one that is willing to always dig themselves in, to be humble and go, I got more growing to do. I got more learning to do. I got more time that I need to be on my knees to do praying. David recognized that he still had a lot more growing and maturing to do, and so do we all. We need to humble ourselves and recognize that. And say, God, give us strength, give us help to be more like you. Holiness, Christ-likeness. Jesus, we need more of you to fill us in that way. And then here he kind of, towards the end, finishes in verse 16, he says, may all who search for you be filled with joy and gladness in you. May those who love your salvation repeatedly shout, the Lord is great. Here's the fifth and final part. Is David didn't want just this for himself, but he wanted to encourage others. He wanted to encourage to say, may all who search you be filled with joy and gladness. The maturing, growing believer is one that desires for others to also grow and mature, to not be a stumbling block, but be an encouragement. Who in your life can you be an encouragement for them to also grow in their life, in their faith, in their relationship with Jesus? To not get in their way, but be a light, be a mentor, be an encouragement. That's what David was to others, wanting to encourage, may all who search you. Who can we help search and discover who Jesus is and what Jesus has done in our lives? So there's those 5 points. A maturing believer is one that waits patiently, but sees God at work. Is one that praises God in all seasons. Recognizes what God has done. A maturing believer is also someone that listens to God, always willing to listen to God, hear His voice. Third, the maturing believer is always one who's willing to share the goodness of God with others. Fourth, the maturing believer is one who is humble, always to repent, say sorry, willing to learn, willing to grow. And fifth, a maturing believer is one who is willing to encourage others in their journey. You see, when I've been here at camp, another picture that helps me think of the maturing believer is campfires. I don't know if you can see back, there's a campfire, obviously not lit, it's so hot. I was going to light a fire, but it's so hot, I didn't bother. But I think you know what a campfire looks like. But I think of a campfire, and I think of a maturing Christian. You see, a maturing Christian, someone who's, and when I say maturing Christian, by the way, I mean a disciple of Christ. Because that's what a disciple of Christ is someone who's willing to grow. It's a journey. And a disciple of Christ is similar to a fire, is at first, it has that flame given by God. I mean, we're lighting fires here, having a bonfire. You need the wood. I didn't create that wood. God created that wood. You need oxygen. I don't create oxygen. God created the oxygen. You need God's grace and love to find him. It's his death and resurrection that we are saved. So we need him to light that fire. But here's the thing. Jesus doesn't want you to have a fire 30 years ago and then just look at the embers the rest of your life. No, he wants us to keep stoking that fire, keep feeding that fire, keep breathing more of him on that fire. We need him to fill us. If you want a short bonfire, sure, you put some logs on, light it, and leave it. But in 30 minutes, it's going to die down and you're not going to be able to cook your burgers or even melt a marshmallow. You need to keep it fed, keep it going. And I think of that disciple, the growing, maturing believer, willing to keep, no matter the season of life, keep stoking, poking, feeding that flame, keeping it hot, red hot. There's intentionality to that. Think of ways, praise of ways, and that's one of them, praying, of ways that you can continue to feed your faith, feed that fire within you, to keep burning strong in Jesus and not let it die down. Jesus does not want you to die down. You see, here's the thing. With a fire, if you don't look after it, it goes lukewarm. You read Revelation 3, Jesus does not want you to go lukewarm. He wants you to stay red hot. He wants you to stay red hot in him, your faith red hot. And yes, it needs grace. Absolutely, it needs God to work and grow and work through you and feed you. But you also got to take this. You got to be intentional. What are ways that you can feed yourself? Here's one. Reading the word. Soaking it in. Being obedient to it. Just like David. Being willing to be humble. Learning and growing. It's so great to be here. It's so great to be with friends and family of the church. It's so great to be here in beautiful warm weather. Yes, there's mosquitoes, but hey, good old deets. That helps us there. But here, so good to get in the word. To hear the river running. Knowing that God, you are in this place. You're with us. There's victory in your name. And I want to just keep pursuing you. I want to continue to grow in you in all seasons. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Father, for life in you. Holy Spirit, help us, each and every one of us, to grow in our maturity. Grow in our journey of our faith in you. Thank you that you lit that fire. That without you, without your death and without your resurrection, we wouldn't be here. There would be no hope, but we have hope because of you. Thank you, Jesus, that cross is empty. And God, help us just keep stirring that and poking that fire. We ask for you to continue to breathe Holy Spirit onto us, fanning into flames, Jesus. I pray for those that maybe they feel their faith has turned a bit lukewarm. Jesus, I just pray, Holy God, that you continue to stoke them, but give us the motivation. And maybe today is that day that we go, no, I'm going to go home or be at home already, but I'm going to start reading my Bible more. I want to start praying to you more. I want to start serving. I want to start loving. I want to start forgiving more and more because I want to grow in you. Thank you, Jesus, that we have life everlasting in you. Thank you, Jesus, that you want us to grow red hot in you. in all seasons of life. Thank you that we can praise you in all seasons of life. Thank you that you deliver us into victory. Give us the words to share with others. Give us the humble heart to always seek forgiveness. Give us the ears to listen to your voice, to grow and to continue growing, and to be an encouragement and empower others to do likewise. Jesus, that's the church. Help us be the church, Jesus. We give you this day, always and forever. Amen. Have a blessed week to you all.